I'm Bob Scales, and I was the dean of the USC School of Theatre from 1993 to 2002. And I was at the school at a very interesting transition time. And John Blankenchip, our emeritus professor of the School of Theatre, has been at USC School of Theatre through all of its transition times.
Yes.
And I've always wanted to ask him questions about the school's past. John has recently been honored by his students and the school for his 50 years of service. And John has a great memory. He can tell you who played what roles, maybe what theater or what shows were in what year.
What year? No way.
No way?
No way, okay. I would say.
For certain, you probably even know some of the technicians that worked on the certain mm-hmm. shows. I mean, you just have a really wonderful memory of all that stuff. So, I thought this is a great opportunity to kind of look at the university and the school through your eyes.
Okay.
So that's what we want to do. And I know that you started out your career on the East.
Yes.
And going to school at?
I did my BFA at Carnegie Tech at the time, it's now the Mellon. I got my BFA there in directing and design, and then I got my MFA in directing and design at Yale.
And then you did some military service?
Oh, I had rough military service. I was inducted in April Fool's Day, and at the induction center, Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys were there, and it was all request day. And one of the requests, they said, "We have a request for when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there." And I broke out laughing, and everybody stared at me like I was some kind of a nut. I thought that was very funny. And then I was sent to Fort Sill, and when I studied design at Yale, Donald Oehlenschlager was the teacher, and Alderdice Nickel had been chair of the department, but he went to Washington with the war, and Oehlenschlager went into camouflage. So did Mills and Melzina. They all went into camouflage. So I had to get into camouflage. I wanted to be a camoufleur. So I wrote him, and I was inducted. They called out Blankenship, and I said, "Yes, sir." And they said, "You're being shipped to the 937th Engineer Camouflage Battalion." I said, "Thank you." And then a little later they said, "We can't ship you yet because we don't know where they are." And they'd been in Arizona, and they were shipped to Sioux City, Iowa, which was the point before they're shipped overseas. So I went there, and they were alerted. They were supposed to go, but there was a court-martial because they said so many rounds of we'd been instructed in something we hadn't been instructed in. So they moved us to the banks of the river in tents. And then one of the people there was Bob Paddock, a friend I knew from New York, and he was a scene designer. And he was called to New York for the show, for Winged Victory by Moss mm-hmm. Hart. And I said, "Bob, when you get there, look at my application." And he wrote back and said, "You're in the dead file because you're not union." But anyway, Harry Horner was the designer, and he needed a second assistant, so Bob got me to go to New York. So I had a rough time of it. Yeah. We stayed at the Narragansett Hotel on 94th and Broadway. One day a week, we had to go to the YMHA for 2 hours and work out. And then we just worked the show.
That was your military service?
Well, not, I'm not through. Oh, no, okay. No. So then the show ran in New York for a season. John Forsythe was in it, wonderful guy. And I sort of checked props. I couldn't touch anything because I wasn't a union. So then they did the film of it, and Harry Horner said he needed me in Los Angeles to be assistant designer. I didn't do anything. George Cukor directed it, a marvelous man. And so then I was sent out here, and had a place to stay close to the studio. It's the sister of a fellow who had been in the in the Cedar. He was a greens man in movie business. Mm-hmm. So that was just down on off Pico near the studio. So we did the film then, and then we toured for a season, opened in the old music theater here. It used to be the Methodist Church, down diagonally opposite the Biltmore Hotel. And we toured here, and then we ended up in the South. And Forsyth and I had been put in an application to do special services, so we were shipped to St. Petersburg, Florida. And we got down there, and the water was too warm. So we dreamed up an idea to go to, we looked at a map to see the closest place to New York City, and there was a convalescent hospital at Pawling, New York. Mm-hmm. So we put in an application and sent it to the commanding officer, and in 2 weeks we were shipped there. So that was 90 miles outside of New York City, which was great. And what was interesting there, it was for a hospital for the veterans who had made the physical adaptation to a prosthesis, but not the mental. Uh-huh. And they had a young man who was an amputee. And he wouldn't talk to anybody, he wouldn't exercise, he wouldn't do anything. So the commanding officer got the idea of getting a puppy for him. So he got a puppy for him, and of course then the soldier bonded with that and took him outside to exercise him.
Wow.
So then the CO, American Kennel Club, said they would give any patient any breed dog, pedigreed dog they wanted. So they had all these wonderful pedigreed dogs there in the kennel. Mm-hmm. And it's the first time I'd seen an Afghan hound run, and when they run, they're gorgeous. In New York, they look pretty sad. Mm-hmm. But that, and then when they dropped the bomb, that was the end of it, and I got out.
So how did you get to USC?
From the service, I went to New York. I went and I taught at Sarah Lawrence for 7 years and did shows, lived in the city, and got one show a year for about 7 years, on or off Broadway. Meals and Irma Zener is the only one that made enough living of just shows, but mm-hmm. Owenslager taught at Yale and all that. So then
that was a normal thing for the designers.
Oh, they had to because even then there wasn't that much work for except for the very top person.
Right.
So then I had a sabbatical, and I got a call. Yale said that USC was looking for a designer. So I interviewed with Walter DeClue, who was then head of the opera department here. Mm. And they hired me, and I came out here at semester break, so I started in February 1955. You don't remember, but I do. And so that's it.
Mm-hmm. And what did you find?
I talked to DeClue, I said, oh, it's that beautiful campus in Westwood. And they said, no, we're closer to the Coliseum. And I said, oh, well, that's nice, okay. So I came out here, and I looked for a place close to campus. Then Stopgap Theater was there at the corner of Hoover and Exposition. And there was an apartment building across the streets. So I got a room there.
Mm-hmm. So how many were in the faculty and what was happening?
It was after the service, and there were a lot of GIs.
Okay.
And it was interesting because then they had more men than women students.
Hmm.
Which has obviously changed because Daddy doesn't want son to be an actor. And William DeMille, Cecil's brother, William DeMille founded the department, and he was in a kind of a church structure that used to be where Founders Hall is now, and then they had to move. They were going to tear that down to build Founders, and they had to find him a temporary space, so he found a substation electric house at the corner of Exposition and Hoover Boulevard, and he named it Stopgap Theater.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a wonderful space, actually, because it only seated 99, and one of our students did Oedipus Rex for his thesis master's production, and we had the row of seats that had been given us from the law school in a row, you know, really nice. And Jim Condon was the name of the student, and he said, can I tear this out and do a semicircular seating, which he did, which was wonderful. So we had semicircular seating, and we did that, and it was very successful.
So it just stayed that way then?
It stayed that way until it was had to be torn down because they really thought it was an eyesore. It was a great space, great space. And because they said the roof wasn't safe and it wasn't earthquake proof and all that jazz, and it would have cost $200,000 to put it up, bring it up to code. So that was it.
Yeah.
So we were out of that. The students, and they had the barracks next door where we rehearsed around the columns, the support. We had a little bungalow across the street that where the offices were. And Dr. Butler was chairman at that time.
Well, tell me about Butler. I've heard
Butler
so many
was, he'd taught in high school. He had a PhD. His specialty was Greek theater. He was wonderful in that. And he used to give an exam of 100 questions on mythology. And any student had to pass that exam before they could go on. So
he was tough, huh?
Yeah, but very good. And we had we had an adjunct teacher in playwriting. That was about, it was a small faculty.
Now, DeMille had already gone.
He died the year before I got here. I didn't kill him.
Okay. What about, was there a DeMille kind of heritage or something as a result of him starting the?
No. Apparently there wasn't. Agnes, at one time, there was a huge picture of him that had been in the offices. I think it was in Alex Siegel's office, who was a chair later on. And all of a sudden, Agnes DeMille was doing some kind of an exhibit out here, and she had heard about the photograph, and she wanted it. We couldn't find it. So somebody had lifted it.
Hmm. So there's hardly a trace of DeMille in there being involved with the school. You also mentioned Siegel. Okay, tell me about Alex.
Alex, he was quite a character. He was when I was at Carnegie, he was getting his master's there. And then he went from there into television at the early stages and rose to the top. He became probably one of the top directors for television. He did all the big stars, directed all of them. And had a very volatile temper. And at that time, our offices were in Parkview, which is a building across the street from Stopgap Theater, on the fourth floor. And Aki Mizuno at that time she had been the financial person for the department, but he put her in as the receptionist in the office. And she hated the job. So the phone would ring and she'd say, "Drama!" Like daring you to ask who it was. Anyway, one day Alex was having a terrible fit and the people upstairs were complaining because his language and his volume. But this one day he was having a terrible fit. Nobody was in the office except Alex and Aki. And this long tirade, huge, just awful, and volume kept mounting. All of a sudden he stopped. And Aki looked up and said, "What?" I'd love to have seen the take on his face.
Did he have a sense of humor as well?
Oh, he had a good sense of humor, yes.
So he knew he was kind of over the edge?
Well, he was very volatile. I mean, if he didn't like a set, he'd go up and kick his foot through the scenery. Oh, yes.
Wow.
And he was teaching the MFA class, and one day Tanita Kelly came in late, and he started to chew her out. And she said, "Alex," she said, "my cat has leukemia, and I had to take her to the vet." And I said, "Well, okay."
Well, it seems like there a lot of things happened during Alex Siegel's time. Changes, right? Or additions?
Well, I think we became the School of Performing Arts at that time.
Now, that's Beglerian,
that's
right?
That's Beglerian. Who
tell me a little bit about Grant Beglerian.
He was marvelous person. In fact, he was the one that, when they built the School of Performing Arts, supposedly, at that time, there were plans for all the buildings, music, drama, and cinema, the whole complex, and it was going to cost $10 million only. And
that'd be a bargain.
The president said, "Oh no, we need the money for the School of Medicine." Mm. So we didn't get it, so they built it. But Beglerian was really marvelous in terms of the performing arts. And to me, that's a very important thing, and I think it's too bad that it's no longer, that term isn't fashionable. Mm-hmm. Because he really was trying to combine the arts, the performing arts, and have them cut across the disciplines. Mm-hmm. And we did some of that, but not nearly enough.
Mm-hmm. Now, during this period of time that Anna Bing Arnold,
who
is another important person.
But very important. She was at the dedication. I was on the building committee.
Well, tell us what is her connection to the school? Because I need to kind of fill everybody in. She was probably the largest donor, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, at that time, probably
at
was.
At that time.
Probably
and
was.
And the only facility that the School of Theatre really has is the Bing Theatre.
Yes.
In which she was the
She gave the money.
Giving.
And also at the meetings, the School of Music, Alex said it would, she said, what size do you want, Alex? And he said 500 max. So then the School of Music got in the act and they were trying to up it because of the opera. They wanted more. She said no. She said, this is built for the theater department and it's going to be the capacity Alex wants, $500, 500 seats. So that put an end to that. So then it was interesting the way they kind of milked the lady because they got building going on the building. The groundbreaking was very impressive. And then they decided there was too much concrete exposed and couldn't we get some brick around it? So they hit her up for some more brick. So she put brick around most of it. Then they said, oh, we need a fountain out in front of the theater between the School of Theater, I mean, the Bing and the cinema. So they put that fountain in, which looks like an inverted douche to me. And when NBC did a special here, they brought in their own fountain and shot up. They also needed the orchestra pit, and they hit her again for that. She gave more money for that. Mm-hmm. Now, she was very generous. And at that time, we were starting to do things in Edinburgh, and a Japanese student, graduate student, Michiko Suzuki, came and worked with in the costume department, but also we were going to do Rashomon in mm-hmm. Edinburgh. And I wrote to Mrs. Bing Arnold and said, we have this student, very gifted student from Japan, that we wants to do, would like to have her do the lead in Rashomon, in Edinburgh. But we need some money. I mean, we would need $1,000. I wrote her on Thursday. On Monday, I had a check for $1,000.
It's wonderful. Yeah.
So then the next year, we needed to raise money again. And I went to Dr. Butler and I said, what do you think about going to Mrs. Arnold again and asking for some? He said, oh, ask for $25,000. I said, Dr. Butler, I don't think I should. He said, oh, no, she's good for it. Ask for that. So I wrote and thanked her for the other thing and asked for $25,000. I got a letter back from her lawyer saying, Mrs. Bing's money for the next year is committed. And then at that time, she was married to the English professor, Arnold, mm-hmm. here. And I saw him and I said, how does she take to that? And he said, she was not happy with you.
Yeah.
And I said, I didn't want to do it.
Right.
But, no. But she was a wonderful, wonderful lady.
Now, in that, you've touched a whole lot of other bases. Let's mm-hmm. talk about Edinburgh. Tell me how, just kind of relay how USC got involved in it, how you got hooked on that.
I had my first sabbatical in 1966, I think. Is that 7 years after 55?
Yeah.
I think I took one whenever I could, every 7 years. And I went to Edinburgh at the festival, and I saw the production, Oxford and Cambridge and all the other productions. But at that time, Rudolph Bing was head of the official festival. That's mm-hmm. before he went to the Met.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, we can do better than this. So I went to the Fringe Society, and I said, would American group be welcome here? And the woman said, we'd love to make the Fringe International. Of course, we've never had an American group here.
Hmm.
So I looked around and saw the different venues and that sort of thing. And there was one venue that was, it had been a church, and then it was a square building that had a pipe organ and where the pulpit was, and then it had seven rows of semi-concentric rows of wooden pews. And I flipped over the space, and I saw a show there, a Kurt Vile show there. And so then then I came back and said, you know, I would love to do this. And they said, okay. And so we did, at that time, we did a rep. In the summer, we did all the plays in rep before we went. Mm-hmm. And we were there. So anyway, we got this space. When I went over to look for it, I contacted the university man who was in charge of letting it. And he said, well, he said, there's only one toilet. And so you'd have to have put up a marquee. I didn't know about a marquee. To them, it's a tent.
Yes.
For the men outside. So, and he did all these things, gave me all these conditions. So I ran around town like crazy and came back and gave him all the answers. And he said, well, that's very impressive. He said, okay. So I put down a $500 deposit and we got it. Mm-hmm. And it seated about 300 people in those seven rows. It was a marvelous space. It was even more compact than Stopgap. The person was, the farthest person from the stage was 25 feet with these concentric rows.
Mm-hmm. And pews, you can kind of stick people
we
a little tighter.
They had little things for the communion cups. We didn't serve drinks. But then Bill White went with us, and Bill had a friend that was teaching in the fine arts department who was wonderful at doing posters. It was in the 60s, and in those days he did these gorgeous posters they would put up, and they would disappear because all the students wanted them for the rooms because they were really high art. Anyway, he went with us, and he did the program, and the American Embassy let us use the space there to working on the program itself. So we had a very impressive program the first year, and I hired a wonderful photographer, Helen Miyakovich, who did all the photos for the program. They are superb. She has the ability of coming in and taking a photo that's the essence of the play in one photograph. One of the students did Finnegan's Wake, and she came in and did a photograph of that. It was Finnegan asleep in a coffin with his hands crossed, and his ring was in focus. And by the time you got to his eyes, it was a dead look. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we got a full page of that in the old Theatre Arts Monthly.
Wow.
With that photo.
That's good.
The Music Center got four pictures on a page, but four on one page. We got one page. So
that kind of started you.
That started it, and we got wonderful notices. When we first started, like we did our late show at 10:30 at night, was Les Bouffes sur la Toile by Millot and Cocteau, a mime, and also Archie and Mehitabel, which is by, it's a wonderful musical on the cockroach that falls in love with a cat, and he writes notes to him by jumping on the keys of the typewriter. And we did that. We got marvelous reviews the first year.
Mm-hmm. So over history, I have so many questions.
Well, let me just go on with Edinburgh. From that first season, a man from London came to see it, and he said, have you ever thought about playing in London? And I said, no, but I'd love to. He said, well, there's a university theater close to in London that might be interested in it. And also, because of the reviews, we got a gentleman from the Holland Festival came to see it, and he said, would you like to appear at the Holland Festival? I said, yes, we would.
Now, was this with all students at that time?
Yeah, they were all,
They're all students, USC students?
A couple of alums.
Okay.
But mostly
students and a couple of alums.
In fact, that first year, I learned, we performed for 3 weeks. Our late show, every night was the same. But at noon, 2, 4, 7, and 9, we did different shows. So the thing was, we opened the first week, and then we had to keep rehearsing for the second week, and then the second week we had to rehearse for the third week. So then after that, we decided we would set not so many performances of each, but each thing would get 6 performances, mm-hmm. and we would do it just in rep, and that would be it. So that's what happened there. And then we got invitations to that. And then also, we got a short article in the New York Times is what really set it all off. Mm-hmm. The guy flipped out over us. And from that, the State Department said, would you like to tour the America houses, A-M-E-R-I-K-A, in Germany? Mm-hmm. And what the America house is, in 10 cities in Germany, they have the America house, which is a library and a sort of a concert, not a big stage, a small speaker stage. And so we applied for that, and we toured there three different times. Wow. We had to get to Germany, but then they paid our expenses.
Mm-hmm. Now, this particular group and the students and the alums mm-hmm. that have done this, I mean, this is something that you hear, I heard all the time I was a dean. Mm-hmm. This was probably the most significant thing in their life at that particular time.
They said, they call it the boot camp, because mm-hmm. we were there for 5 weeks. We built a theater for the first 2 weeks and rehearsed for that time, and then we performed for 3 weeks. So they were working. In fact, one student wrote, sent me a thank you note, a very good actor, and he said, I want to thank you, he said, because I didn't realize how much I could do mm-hmm. and would be pushed to do. Mm-hmm. And you pushed me, but I thank you for it. He said, mm-hmm. now I feel I can do anything.
Yeah. Well, and it kind of mirrored, didn't it, like summer stock?
Oh, yeah,
when
yeah.
You were,
yeah.
So yeah. Did you build that kind of off that, or you kind of saw what seemed to work at the festival?
Well, the thing is, you go into a space that isn't a theater, and you have to convert it into a theater. Yeah. And we did this in different places. One place we went the third year, we had this gorgeous place, one of the most beautiful rooms I've ever seen. It was about 50 foot wide. You go up a flight of steps, and then you come into a space, and you go up two flights of steps, and you're on a balcony that goes clear around, a U-shaped balcony. And that's supported by columns that went from the floor, obviously supported the balcony, they went on up to the roof, and then to a peak. There were, I flipped over that space, and we got it for a couple of years. And the skylights, I said, well, we have to black those out. And they said, fine, but you can't do it. He said, you have to have somebody do it, because we don't have anybody else on the roof. So we hired somebody that came in, and they would bend up the copper, put tar paper down and bend mm-hmm. it back. There were 27 skylights in that
wow.
one room. Some of them as big as 8x12. Mm. And that was a gorgeous space.
Now, one of the things that you mentioned, I want to try to get more in here,
okay.
Was Bill White.
Oh, Bill.
And Bill was here, wasn't he
was
the
here
first
when
student?
I came.
Wasn't he the first student of DeMille?
He came here as a teaching assistant to get his master's with DeMille. And DeMille taught and did lighting and in Bovard without too much equipment at that time. And DeMille, he wanted things bright because of his vision. Whereas when De Clou came, Bill was lighting the opera, and Bill said, the chorus is awfully dark, isn't it, Walter? Well, I said, keep it dark, they're not very good. But Bill was a wonderful lighting man, and also he taught, and he was a very good acting teacher. In fact, he taught Restoration Comedy, and he was one of the two people we've had that could really teach it. He and Charles Vernon did the same thing. Mm-hmm. Bill had the whole thing, the lesson of the fan he found in some mm-hmm. book. And he was a marvelous, very gentle person. And
When I came, he was really the person who knew all the academic stuff, right?
Oh, he knew he'd been here so long, he checked every course, the description for every course. He knew how to word it,
right.
Where the commas had to go so it would go through the committee.
Yeah.
So and some of our more recent faculty sort of resented it. I said, listen, he knows how to get it through the committee. Don't bother. Let him do what he has to do. So they did.
Yeah, he was really a asset to me when I first came here, being able to get
things
done.
Well, he's that
done.
Kind of a person. He was very, the ego, he was a co-worker.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, he passed away on us before we could get him
you know, to be right. able to do
he
what
he started the
doing.
History of the department, because it went on for I don't know how many years before I got here. Okay, yeah. I don't even know, can't even remember when it was founded.
There's some other people I want to kind of mention all that right. we haven't talked about yet, yeah. and I'd like to know more about John Houseman and what yeah. his role and how he got involved and what okay. period that happened.
I had a student named Hal George. He came here, a beautiful artist, drawings, costume designer. And I said, Hal, I said, I you paint much better than I do, but I said, I think I can teach you how to get character into your costume sketches, which I did. And he did, he was very grateful, and he did sketches for Three Sisters that we did, gorgeous sketches. And at that time, Houseman was head of 90 Minutes in New York at CBS. So I took the sketches to New York because they were going to do it in Connecticut that summer. And I took them up to him, and he said, these are very good, but Hal would elongate the neck and all of his figures, one head. Mm-hmm. He said, but tell him to get rid of those damn necks. And also, Houseman said, in costume sketches, I don't like faces to be painted, because to me, the actor brings that. I don't want to be influenced.
When he's looking at costumes, he wants to look at costumes.
So well, that was my contact with Houseman. But then when we were looking for someone, for a chair, we suggested him because he had been out here and interviewed he and Michelle Saint-Denis
for didn't
Juilliard.
Realize that. Mm-hmm.
And we had lunch, and the Frenchman was wonderful. I said, Michelle Saint-Denis, I said, it seems to me that we have trouble teaching styles, period styles. And I said, it seems to me that we need to do the realistic stuff first and then go to the styles. And he said, no, you do them simultaneously. I said, well, how can you do that? He said, you just do the script. I felt like such an ass. But anyway, then after that, they'd been trying to get Houseman. And one of our adjunct people, who I've forgotten what he taught, but he ran into Houseman at the Music Center and asked him if he might be interested. And so he expressed interest, so we got him. Mm-hmm. But he didn't want to be, after Juilliard, he didn't want to be chair. No.
Okay.
He would be, I think he was a distinguished visiting professor.
Okay. So was there an influence? Did he kind of influence the curriculum and things of that nature
while
he was here?
At that time, then he got the paper chase while he was here.
Oh, so.
And then he got kind of guilt feelings because of being away a bit doing that film. So then he said he'd do a production. So he did a production of a Shakespeare. And Janet Bolton, wonderful woman who taught with us, she played one of the parts, and Madeline Smith played another part because Houseman was very taken with Madeline Smith's talent. Mm-hmm. And he was very helpful, and we had a faculty meeting one day. Excuse me. And at the end of the meeting, Houseman said, I'm a little nervous today. He said, I hope you'll forgive me. And he said, I guess I should tell you. He said, I'm meeting with Orson Welles today at 5:00. And I haven't met with him since he threatened to kill me.
Wow.
But he was a marvelous person.
Well, Orson Welles was one that I always wished that I had an opportunity to work with. Anyway, another person, Duncan Ross.
Duncan was...
he came after John Houseman, right? Mm-hmm.
On one of my sabbaticals, he was head of at Bath or Bath school there, and I went to see him because I'd read what wonderful reviews he'd gotten on his directing, and also. So I went to see him. They were on holiday, so I didn't meet him. But we finally got him here, and He said, oh, Pinter was a student of mine. He said, in fact, he was a student of mine when he wrote his first play, The Room. He said, and we staged it, which is quite interesting. Mm-hmm. No, he was a marvelous director. He'd been at Seattle Rep.
Right, well, I was at Seattle Rep. Yeah. He had just hired me at Seattle Rep. Mm-hmm. And then I did one season with him mm-hmm. there. And then he showed up down here.
And he was amazing, had amazing ability to get a student, I mean, to get an actor on the right track. He would go in, and I've seen a rehearsal when they were floundering, and then I went in after, and I was at a session where he talked to them for 10 or 15 minutes, and then had them do it, and they're all on track. Mm. And also, people kept saying, well, why don't you write it? You should write a book. You should write a book. And I think he may have tried, but I don't know. He couldn't get his approach on paper.
Right. I don't think he went to school.
Oh, no, he didn't. He didn't have an advanced degree beyond high school.
And I think he was a practical person, right? And just totally practical.
He didn't like things called costumes. They're stage clothes. They're not called really? Costumes. Interesting, but it does for an actor.
Right.
And we had a very distinguished, what's his name, the historian from Texas.
Brockett.
Brockett was here, came here. Brockett left Texas and he came here. And he was heading up the PhD program. And Brockett came in a couple times during the year and said, I've gone to Ross two or three times asking him what he wants me to do, and I don't get any kind of an answer. And so Brockett resigned. And I finally came to me, I think it's what happened was that Ross, because of his lack of formal educational mm-hmm. training and history of the theater, felt uncomfortable trying to advise Brockett. That's just my own approach, mm-hmm. but I think that's true.
Yeah.
Because he was really a practical person.
Right,
person.
And he did have a thing about education.
Oh, well.
It was kind of interesting
because he
was
Mammoth.
He was he was in education, you know, and he was one of a super teacher from everyone that I know that he's worked
but
with.
But I think he
but he
felt
had some phobia
subconsciously.
About,
I think he felt
because he didn't have the background.
He didn't feel secure. Yeah. Couldn't back it up with his footnotes.
Well, so Brockett. I was curious about Brockett because I had seen his name and
no that's why he went back to Texas time. I think
there were other let's say the next one was like Toscan right no so we don't talk
he fired,
about
oh, no we can talk we sure
we don't
can.
Talk about Toscan because see this again
Toscan
is before
was,
my
it's interesting because we got a letter that he was going to revolutionize scene design in the United States.
Toscan?
Oh, yes. And that's when he hired, who was that artist? He hired the one that does those one, well, he was going to do the bow and tie down in front of the music center, the new music, the Disney Hall. What's his name? Famous artist. Had an exhibit down at the contemporary.
Christie or something?
No. With an A, I think it is. My alphabet mind.
Okay.
Anyway, his exhibit, I went down to see it, and there was an elevator, and you step in the elevator, and they close the door, and you hear all this sound. And they open the elevator, and you step out, you're in the same floor you were. And he did an exclamation point. It was about 10 feet high. And he had taken a huge broom from a street cleaning kind of thing and made it into an exclamation point. Mm-hmm. He also did a...
We don't even know who we're talking about.
Well,
here.
I can't think of the man's name. He's well known.
Okay.
If you know who's doing the bow tie for the get,
is that yet to come or something new or is
well,
it happen?
They designed it, but then they were afraid it would fall apart because it wasn't properly designed. So then they had to get it. They're trying to get another million or so to reinforce it. I think so. It isn't up yet, but it goes right at the corner.
Well, let's go back to Toscan.
Okay. He came, he was teaching. We hired him because his PhD was in the history of the American theater. Mm-hmm. That's why we hired him. And so he taught it for 1 year. And then he said he didn't want to teach that anymore, so he didn't. Mm-hmm.
Now, didn't he do playwriting or something? Or was he involved with something to do with playwriting, Toscan?
I'm trying to think of, he taught literature courses, and I think he may have taught playwriting, yeah. Mm-hmm. And,
well, the reason, the reason I...
I'll be very open about my reaction to Toscan. When I hit 65, then I stayed on till I was 70, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And then they put me on, then I became emeritus, and they put me on, and I continued to teach Toscan for a year. And at the end of that year, I thought I was all set, and I got a notice thanking me for my service to the department. Mm-hmm. So then I thought, well, what happened? Because I was getting good evals. Mm-hmm. So I went to the vice president and said, you know, what could happen about this? And he said, well, he said, I don't think legally we can do anything about it.
Was it a mandatory?
Yeah, well, no, you know, my mandatory was when I hit 70 or 75.
Right. So,
so then I had a year, so then I got the notice. Thank you, but no more.
Okay.
So then... The students, the alums, got up in arms, and they said, do you mind if we write letters to the president? And I said, no, I'm fine. I said, you was the best stationer, you got the best letterhead. So they sent 200 letters in. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know all this. I knew some of it was happening, I didn't know. And then the day before school was to start, I got a call from Toscan. And he said, would you like to teach this year? And I said, oh, I'd love to. He said, okay, you're on. What had happened? Five or six of the alums, I won't name their names, had gone to Toscan and said, we will pay his salary for a year, which they did. Mm-hmm. And then these letters came, and then that
kind of sealed it.
Yeah. Well, and then he went on to become the, he went up to university up north. There was a thing about he was
Oregon, wasn't it?
I don't know. He's no longer there. He's someplace else now. The Renaissance man has come to our campus. Okay.
Yeah. Now, the reason I wanted to mention him was that was when the school became a school.
Well,
so tell me, but was he involved with it, or was?
Well, I'll tell you how that happened.
How did this happen?
That happened because all of a sudden we got a grant of $1 million from somebody we'd never heard of her. She had taken a dance class under the School of Theatre. Way back before, I mean, when somebody was here, and that's how we got that $1 million. So with that, Toscan was able to get them to change the name to a School of Theatre, because they thought more money coming in.
Oh, amazing.
That was it. So, and also then they got Massman to donate some money to remodel a theater there in the current headquarters.
Let's talk about students. We've kind of...
Students, they go in cycles.
Okay.
I think. When I was here, we had one of the most exciting cycles I've ever seen. Michael Pataki, Paul Comey, Gretchen Connie, Carol Ann Daniels. They've all had good professional careers. They were in that first outfit.
Now, about what era is that?
That was way back. That was in the 50s.
That's in the 50s. Well, okay.
And then we've had... And interesting, since that time, I went to see a play called David and Lisa. Don't ask me how long ago. Louis Padilla directed it in Stopgap. And after the show, I went up to Louis and I said, Louis, where did that boy come from? She said, Tate Donovan? She said, he can't even be a drama major. His father won't let him be a drama. I said, what do you mean? No, his father's a doctor. And he said, if a son of mine wants to be an actor, he can pay for it. So I went to Tate and I said, Tate, do you mind if I write a letter to your father? I said, I've never done this before. He said, no, please do. So I wrote and said, I've never done this before. I think your son is potentially a professional caliber. And I think it would be nice if you would let him be an actor. So that fall, Tate got to be an actor.
Yeah, well, he's certainly been successful at it. Really successful at it. Yeah. So talk more about the cycles. Well, you've got the John Ritter group.
Yeah.
I mean, that was kind of a sweet group in there.
And at that time, who's doing the Oscar this year? What's her name? Carol Zinner? Mm-hmm. She was one of our students, and then she switched from drama to cinema because she said Laura Owens was getting all the leads. It's Jack Bender's current wife now, who's doing Lost. So that was Jack and Jack Bender, John Ritter, Diana Gibson that you haven't heard of, but she,
I've met her actually.
She's a wonderful
playwright, isn't she?
When I was teaching experimental drawing, I decided we'd do a musical based on the Bible. So I said everybody has to write a sketch or a song based on the Bible. So we got these limp things coming in, except Diana came in, and she had a cassette. And I said, "What's this?" And she said, "Well, this is five songs I wrote." So we played the songs, and they were superb. And I said, "Well, Diana, you're going to write the whole show." She said, "Ah!" So she did 13 songs. I took them to a friend of mine, Dick Prebor, who had been musical director for Marge and Gower Champion. And I said, "Can you make a lead sheet of this?" Because she didn't know how to write a note of music. And he did. And he said, "This one song," he said, "is very unusual. The time signature and the key," he said, "it's very seldom used. It's very difficult, but she's used it, and it's exactly right for what she's doing." Mm-hmm. So we did that show, and it was marvelous. And we did it here, and then we did it in Edinburgh, and we did it for the State Department.
Mm-hmm. What was the name of the show?
The Word.
The Word.
It was just based on the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. And a kid from Carnegie came to see it in Edinburgh, mm-hmm. and then he wrote, you know what?
Godspell?
Godspell.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So a ripoff, huh?
Well, we could say that.
Inspired.
Yeah,
inspired.
Yeah.
Right.
The muse sat on his shoulder.
Yeah.
You know, and then right now I'm teaching one class, beginning directing, and I've got a very good group of kids in there.
Well, for me, in my era, I thought the class at Sari and Barry and hot kids. I mean, they could.
Sari went on and got her master's from new school. It was in a good group.
Yeah.
And of course, Joni Tewksbury was in there someplace, and she's
right.
a wonderful, wonderful talent.
Yeah. And let's see if I have some other names here. You've just about covered most of them. But I want to know more about Michiko. And Faye and Michael Kanin.
Yeah, we did.
And
we
how
did.
All that picture.
Okay, Michiko,
tell me those stories.
She came here and she was working on her MFA, and she was costume assistant. And at that time, I did the first musical, which was The Boyfriend. And I had her do a cummerbund. It was tucked, red and tucked. And she showed her, I said, "Michiko, that's right." She said, no, Mr. Brad, no. And she tore it all out. She said, I have to redo it. And she would, little, and she would, instead of walking, she'd run places. Mr. Blankenship, I'm so tired. Anyway, we did Rosh Shaman and had her do the lead. And Michael Pataki played the bandit. And she knew how to use the paper fan, which is very difficult to open, but she could like that. And there's one line in the play where the bandit says, "I'm going to rape you." And she flicked her fan and she said, "You wouldn't, would you?" And the Faye and Michael Kanin came to see it.
Mm-hmm. Now they're the playwrights, they're the authors.
Yeah, they adapted it. They also, the Tony Perkins thing, the other play about, I can't think of the name of it right now, Americana. Anyway, they came to see it, and Mrs. Kanin flipped over Pataki, and Mr. Kanin flipped over Michiko. And Michiko was, she knew how to, she had studied the Kabuki and other things in Japan for a couple of years, and I said, "Michiko, would you do? Can't we do one of these?" She said, "Oh no, Mr. Blankenship, I only studied that for 2 years."
Now, in terms of how did student like her, was she a Japanese student?
She was Japanese.
And so
she adapted. I mean, she was very bright and very gifted, and everybody loved her. You know, she was fine.
And what do you remember? What era that happened to be in? Was it?
It was in the 50s, and we went to Edinburgh about after that. You know,
so that long ago.
Yeah. And then we got permission to do Rashomon, and then they were going to do a professional production on Vine Street. The theater's been torn down now. And they tried to stop it, but Samuel Prince said, no, they paid their royalty, you can't stop it. So Michiko and I went to see it. This was after we had done it, and we got a very good review in the LA Times. Anyway, we went to see it. And the wife rides in on a little white pony they had, and she alights, and they tie the pony facing upstage, which was a mistake. And the pony lifted his tail, and Michiko did it. And the bride turned around, and Michiko went, said, what's the matter, Michiko? She said, Mr. Blankenship, the bride is dead. I said, what do you mean the bride is dead? You only wrap your kimono that way when you're dead. They did an opera at the Greek theater, and they had hired Aki and Michiko as consultants to adjust, get the costumes just right.
So, Akiko, what is?
Aki Mizuno.
Aki.
No, Aki, yeah. Now, Michiko Suzuki and Aki Mizuno. Yeah.
Okay, Aki, tell me, she worked as a staff person?
She was in charge, and then when Toscan came, she was in charge of the financial end of it.
Okay.
And Toscan had an assistant who had been a graduate student at the time. And Toscan went to Aki and said, Aki, will you do all the financial work? And she said, yes, if I do all of it. Because this other person had been putting her oar in.
Mm-hmm.
So Toscan didn't agree to that. So
didn't work out.
No. Huh? So then Michiko, they let her go, and she went someplace else on campus, and then she sued for age discrimination. And I said, how did you do? She said, I won. I said, how was the settlement? She said, I'm not allowed to tell you.
Because she had been here, I guess.
Oh, yeah. And then she was teaching Japanese. Michiko was also teaching Japanese while she was here. Marvelous teacher, apparently.
What about Michelle Engelman?
Oh, special lady.
Yeah.
Michelle was here her first year. She was terrible. Very numb. I mean, she couldn't get through a sentence.
Is it, you mean just as nervous?
Nervous?
You
know, well, it was just.
Boy, you wouldn't. I wouldn't.
She's
I can't imagine.
So gorgeous. And you think, but by the time she was a senior, boy, she had bloomed. She did Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. She did Maggie. Gorgeous, gorgeous ability. And no, she's very, very, very special.
And being Rod Dedeau's daughter,
daughter, and I was invited to the wedding, her first wedding.
Mm-hmm.
Simple though, she married Jack. Michel Dedeau's soiree. His name was Soiree. And when we were in Edinburgh one summer, he was in Paris, and he was in an accident. And she flew over to see him. We didn't think she should marry him. You know, we didn't know anything about it. We shouldn't. He wasn't good enough for her.
Yeah.
Anyway, they had 10 bridesmaids and 10 all this, and then it didn't work out. So she adopted a child, a daughter, and they divorced, and then she remarried. And she had a son by her second husband, who's now up in school here.
He's going to school here now?
I think he's here now, and I think he wants to. And then he wants to be a cinema. He wants to do graduate work in cinema.
Yeah.
He's getting a business degree now.
Mm. Well, that's his dad, right?
She is wonderful, wonderful.
These are some names.
She really bloomed. Well, in Edinburgh, she was in one of the shows. And our stage was up about 30 inches high, and she walked off that backwards and fell and hit a radiator. We rushed her over to the infirmary. They said, oh, she's fine. She came back here, found out she'd broken her back. So she forgave us, but apparently it's fine. But I mean,
Well, she's been terrific.
Oh, she's marvelous.
And all the time.
Very loyal supporter and, wonderful person. Now,
some of these things.
Oh, wait a minute. Also, they gave, when Bill and I, they established the Bill White John Blankenship mm-hmm. Fund. Mm-hmm. And Michelle lives in
San Marino.
San Marino, and she said, "Well, we're going to." She said, "We're going to have a party for you and Bill benefit." And she said, "We're going to have it outside." I said, "Well, do you have enough room?" Enough room, lawn, tennis court, swimming pool.
They could accommodate.
It was wonderful.
Well, I think they did
and
the Cirque du Soleil there.
Michelle. And Michelle's mother had been very big in Trojan League. Now Michelle is big in Trojan League, but also John Ritter's mother had been was there at the time, so they established that for us.
Well, talk about John Ritter.
Oh, amazing ability, a wonderful guy. And at one time in Stopgap, we were doing some show, and he and Jack Bender, there was a break, and they were outside at night chasing each other around the building. And all of a sudden, a helicopter came over and had a spotlight. They came right back into the eye. John had a wonderful sense of humor. Yeah. And also, we did a show, Jim Bridges and the guy that was in, his friend, Jim Bridges, and he wrote the libretto for an opera.
I can't help you
they
on
did,
this one.
They did a summer of, one time they did a summer of plays in Stopgap. We were in Edinburgh. John didn't go that year. But I can't think of the guy's name. That's awful. Anyway, he had written a play about a one-act play, his Bridges' friend. They came to Edinburgh with us that summer. Had to leave because of the baby maker was going into works. But the play was about a young man that was going around getting magazine subscriptions, knocking on doors, and then he has an epileptic seizure. And John's brother had that trouble.
Oh. Uh-huh.
And I went to John and I said, John, is this too close, or would you be interested in doing this play? Hmm. And he said, no, I would like to do it because I can use my
well,
background.
He would certainly know.
And he was wonderful, and he patted his arm. He flailed all over the marvelous performance.
So he played the epileptic.
He played,
Wow.
And I went to the wedding when he married his first wife at the hotel in Beverly Hills, outside, beautiful wedding. And his brother was his best man. Mm. And at one point, his brother kind of went like this just a bit, and John just reached down and took his hand. Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful moment. Mm. And then his brother did finally become a lawyer. Hmm. Did you know John's father was a lawyer? Tex Ritter had a law degree from the University of Chicago, that old cowboy. Pretty smart.
Yeah.
And one of the banquets, one of the things in Edinburgh, Mrs. Ritter, she would come over every summer, and John said, Dad worries a little because she travels first class. She hires a driver and a car with him all with her all the time. So she gave a dinner for us. And at the party, she jumped up on a radio with one of her three Instamatic cameras. And John said, Mother, get down. She said, oh, John, relax, relax. She'd been an actress with Norris Evans way back.
Mm-hmm. Some of these I don't know. Eric Stoltz.
Marvelous talent, and he and Tate, I admire them because they've continued to be bi-coastal. They do plays in New York and film here, and they're available for both. Mm-hmm. In fact, Tate just did Rabbit Hole in New York. I mean, he didn't do that. He did the show with Judi Dench in New York. I can't remember the name of it. Then he did Rabbit Hole here at the Geffen, and Eric does the same thing. He's done. He was in a revival of Our Town in New York, some other plays in New York, and shows here.
Yeah, I noticed his name in New York.
And I talked to Tate about, Eric about, he'd just done a show with Meryl. What's her name, Meryl?
Meryl Streep?
No. The one that's doing The Queen, the film. The English actress, Helen Mirren.
Helen Mirren,
And he said, he played a young lover with her.
Meryn.
He said they had a scene in bed, and he said, she's hot. No, he's and also in Edinburgh, we did, he was doing the lead in Tommy. And one day, one night, he wrote something I can't say on his stomach. And so I said, you're not going to perform that. He was doing other plays. I said, you're not going to do that anymore. Fortunately, I had an understudy. And then the kids were up in arms. They said, what do you mean you can't do that? And I said, yes, I can, because you don't do that on performance in front of a paid audience. And so they had a meeting, and they said, what about them? And one of the guys, we had a 7-foot-tall basketball player who was with us, said, look, somebody's got to be in charge. And that, they shut up for that. And then Eric was over there one another summer. He was doing a Braveheart. Is that the name of the film?
There is a Braveheart.
And he came by. He had long red hair at the time, and he left a couple $100. He said, have a party for the cast. Mm. No, he's a... So we replaced him in that, and I think he really... He learned his lesson, but no, he's a very good actor and a good person.
What about John Astin?
John Atkins, good and bad. John is a wonderful, wonderful actor. He did a couple of those police things. Very good actor. He married a gorgeous gal. They had 3 or 4 kids. Then he left her, and he's up in Colorado or someplace, I don't know, but he's a very good actor.
I've heard a lot of stories about John Rose.
John Rose is exceptional talent. John Rose, when Elliot Woodruff directed Old Times, John Rose played the guy. It was a brilliant performance. Norma Pissar played the strange lady, and Julie Gibson at the time, she's now married to one of our alums. They were wonderful. John Rose played that. He did, we did an E.E. Cummings play called Him. And we had Goldman, what was his name, from cinema, directed. He's the one that got the first award, big award that was given out for the creative ability. Anyway, in Him, each act is the same. It's just one room, but you see it from a different angle. Each act, it turns a different way. And John Rose was in that play. And of course, there's no punctuation in the script on that. John did a beautiful job. He said, but please, not this again. And he did it. It was in a show that Bill White did, directed in Edinburgh, that was very well done. Yeah.
Well, one of the interesting students that I really kind of represents to me, one of the USC students, is Margot Upham.
Class act.
Yeah. Just smart.
Beautiful, beautiful lady, beautiful talent. When we did the musical about takes place in a flower shop where they have the plants, what's the name of that? Do you remember? I can't think of the name of it.
Little Shop of Horrors.
Little Shop of Horrors. Margot was the bass black voice off stage of the plant. It was, you couldn't believe it was she. Then she did the lead in the Sondheim musical that's all 3/4 time. No, she had marvelous, marvelous talent and a person.
We could talk about students forever, because and it's wonderful, I think, their attitude toward you, you know. I mean,
well, it's a real give and take. We can say anything to each other.
And one of the things I wanted to ask you about too is, you know, looking at the future. Let's look back first. Okay. What do you think were some of the real challenges that the school had to go through, and kind of came out the other side? Some turning points that maybe happened in the school.
I think the point, I don't think there's that much of a turning point. I think the thing is that the kids, because of our location, it's so glamorous, they're going to be movie stars. They think they're going to be movie stars. And they don't realize that not that many of them are going to make it. I mean, even in the theater, let alone film. And a lot of them, in fact, we had one chair that we would go. I went on auditions with him. Jack and I would, and he would look at the. He was going by the photos, movie faces, and we did an audition in Chicago, and this girl came in who was Hispanic, kind of a young character woman, and did this scene, and the man couldn't be there at the time, and Jack and I said, "Well, we've got to get her back. He's got to see her." I'm blocking on the name because I can't even think of the name of who was chair. So we brought her back and she auditioned. And he said, no. So she auditioned for Yale and of course they grabbed her up. And then shortly after she graduated, she was in a show at Lincoln Center. The thing about, well, I'm digressing just a bit, but the thing about the face, I mean, my advice, and I'm not popular for it, if you're a face, you stay here. If you're a talent, you go to East. They don't like to hear that.
Yeah.
But I mean, my point is that if you have ability and you prove yourself as an actor in New York, they want you here. They'll come to you. And some of the kids here are able to make it from here, but not that many. Because all the big stars basically put in their time in New York.
So you're saying even our students should do the New York
part
shot
of the
or
training,
get training there.
The training is so good. I mean, it's so flexible. They don't realize. And of course, now with the internship down at the Music Center, that's very good because they get it, not just at the Music Center, but for different agencies and so on. And a lot of our students take advantage of that, and then they go into work for one of those companies after they graduate. The thing is, the training is so good. You don't realize how good it is and how applicable it is for other jobs.
You're right.
Theater we had training. One boy here, Buckley Norris, who did all the leads when he was here. And we did the lead in The Devil in that musical. And he got a top agent, and she kept sending him out, and he didn't get in. I said, "What's the matter, Buck?" He said, "Well, they send me out against these 6-foot guys." He said, "I'm only 5'9". He went to work at Felix Chevrolet. And in a month, he was their top salesman. He said, "Buckley, how do you do that?" He got all these. I said, "Buckley, how do you do that?" Oh, he said, "It's easy. I just look at the customer and say, what do they want me to be? And I'm that, and I sell them." No, my point is, the training is so flexible, going into merchandising, into advertising, management, all that. It's, it's marvelous training. They don't realize that at the time, but it does open them up and makes them saleable. But maybe not as an actor.
Well, one of the things that I found as being a dean, trying to sell a parent, right, they just really didn't want their child to be in theater, is trying to really convince them, this is probably the best liberal arts education your student, your child can get.
I have a current student. He was in an accident. His car was totaled. He came in, he was working 2 or 3 jobs. He came in the other day and he said, "I have a feature film starting January 16th. I said, "Not." He said, "Yeah." I said, "I bet your dad is glad to hear that." He said, "He sure is." No. It's right. It's difficult, and particularly at these prices now.
So let's talk about your idea about the education from. For theater, I know that you really were strong on the MFA and the BFA, right?
Well, and I feel that they don't.
Just give
part
me
of the problem is that it bothers me that they don't really have, our current students don't really have an understanding and appreciation for the literature of the theater, for the important plays, even to me, the important contemporary people are Pirandello, Strindberg, Chekhov, Vedekind. Who?
Yeah.
I mean,
well, some of that, when we say contemporary, John, those are.
To me, that's the beginning of contemporary theater. That's contemporary
beginning, okay. Yeah. But, they're looking at.
Jack Rowe directed the show, and he said something about Tennessee Williams being, a period piece. Well, in a way, he is.
Yeah.
Because I keep saying, who? Yeah. I mean, they don't know. And at their age, they've seen very little live theater, a lot of them, which is unfortunate. The thing with the Music Center helps because they can go see those things. But some of them don't avail themselves of that. And the lack of really wanting anything to base it on, I think one of my pet theories, which I can't convince anybody to do it, is I think history of the theater should be taught in reverse. because I think if you start now,
today, right,
and then see where that came from, then you have an appreciation for what went before.
Right, makes
right
sense.
Now you don't.
It makes sense.
Right now, if you're a new voice, you go right to the top. Mamet, Pinter, who else? Contemporary. Lebut or whatever his name is. If you have a different voice, you go right to the top, and then of course you sell out for film. But you can't blame them with the money they make there. But to continue to do both things, and that's what I respect the British actors and why they are so good, is they do both things simultaneously. And somebody pointed out that over here is the only place where the film center and the theater center aren't in the same city, and so that people can work simultaneously both places. Mm-hmm. But I think our people, a lot of them are too interested in the buck and not in the art. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to say, but it's difficult to live by that. Mm-hmm.
Well, there's one thing that I really respect about you is your passion for theater. You know, I mean,
well,
you love doing it, right?
Well, that's
and you love everything about it.
Yeah.
And I think your Tennessee Williams shows that I've seen, I mean, really have a insight to that. Those
productions. Well, I mean, and Chekhov.
Chekhov, right? There isn't anything you don't know about Chekhov,
well,
is there?
Well, I mean, yeah, there's a lot.
Are
it's fascinating, and the more you go back and every time you go through it, you get something new. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the contemporary stuff, the fluff is just cotton candy.
So we've talked a little bit mostly about the past. What do you kind of see as a path, or where maybe the school, let's talk about the university. What do you think of right now?
Well, this Visions and Voices is a marvelous program. If they would live up to it.
The contemporary thing
well,
that they're doing, right?
Yeah. It bothers me a little bit. People say, well, why don't you just do a reading of the play? Well, you can't do a reading of the play if there's subtext, like this thing of Spring Awakening. To me, it's a very important play because it's what happens when parents don't explain the facts of life to their children. Mm-hmm. And they get in big trouble, and they don't accept the responsibility for that. Mm-hmm. And I just think that, I mean, well, also in the Performing Arts Vatican, I mean, and also to try to get them to read about the author, because so much of it is autobiographical, and they don't realize that. But you read about Tennessee Williams, you read about Vatican, you read about Chekhov. One thing fed the other thing. And in terms of the future, I think again, I was so happy with that when the School of Performing Arts came into existence. Mm-hmm. Because it's not my thing, it's Sondheim, and I mean, Hammerstein. You go so far with dialogue, then you go to heighten it, you go to music, and then if you have to heighten that, you go to dance. Mm-hmm. And that's what Oklahoma blew the lid off everything. Mm-hmm. And West Side Story. When I saw West Side Story, I thought, in the first intermission, I said, well, where the hell can they go in the second act? Well, they did. Yeah. No, to me, that's the exciting thing. And the people, I mean, the use of movement, I mean, the people, some of our people that are very gifted, they go to New York and they can't pass the dance audition. We had one boy who was 6 foot tall, very handsome, very good singer, very good actor, couldn't get through the dance audition. Mm-hmm. So he realized that and he went and took classes, so he finally got through them, and now he's working because he's triple threat. Mm-hmm. And so many of the contemporary people have to be triple threat, and there are not that many good ones. Mm-hmm. But the combination of the arts and the mixed media, when it's done well, not just for shock effect, but for when it's really integral to the piece, is very exciting to me.
Well, I know you really enjoyed Lion King.
Oh, first 10 minutes of Lion King is the most exciting theater I've ever seen. I thought, well, where the hell did that woman come from? So I bought her a book. Boy, she paid her dues. She went to the island. Yeah. She studied this. She studied puppets. She studied marionettes, different movement, shaking all these people she's worked with. She deserves to be where she is.
Right.
I didn't think much of her late opera, but that's okay.
Well, John, it's been wonderful.
Well, it's good to talk
to
you.
And it's great.
Really appreciate what you did for us, too, while you were with us.
While I did my thing, right? Well, we did our thing together, right? Yeah. So I really appreciate it, and thank you so much for doing this.
That's all, folks.